Okay, girls, so now I am going to show you the right answers for your exam. During this century, Don Pelayo founded the Kingdom of Asturias, the last Christian kingdom in Spain. Well, that is going to be the 8th century, of course, because if you remember, the 8th century starts with the entry of Islam to Europe. So, as the Visigoths are defeated, Don Pelayo, the last Visigoth, is going to be able to escape and to found in the northern part of Spain the Kingdom of Asturias, which was the last Visigothic and Christian kingdom in the Hispanic Peninsula by those days. Then, during this century, Justinian, the Eastern Emperor, retakes the north part of Africa and defeats the Ostrogothic Kingdom. That is, of course, in the 6th century. During the 6th century, we have this attempt from Justinian, the Eastern Roman Emperor, to rebuild the Roman Empire. By the end of this century, Odoacer deposes Romulus, the last Western Emperor. So that is, of course, the 5th century. Actually, this marks the end of the 5th century. So as it says over here, the end of this century. So yes, the century may be known as the century of the Franks, as it marks the beginning and consolidation of the Frankish expansion. That is the 6th century. In the 6th century, we are going to have Clovis making these great expansions in the Frankish kingdom. Remember that he is the first Frankish king. During this century, Charlemagne conquered Italy back from the Lombards and gives the territories of Rome to the Pope. So that is the 8th century. And remember that by doing this and by the end of this century, he's going to be crowned as emperor. Then, by the end of this century, Bitiza, king of the Visigoths, dies and is succeeded by Don Rodrigo, despite the opposition of the sons of Bitiza. So that is the 7th century. Remember that this is actually some of the last things that happened during the 7th century, because after that, then Islam is going to enter and they are going to depose and kill Don Rodrigo. During this century, Theodoric the Great is able to control both the Ostrogothic and the Visigothic kingdom. Remember that Theodoric the Great actually was the king of the Ostrogoths and he was ruling in Italy after he killed Odoacer. However, as Alaric II, which was the king of the Visigoths, died in a battle against Clovis, in which the Franks expanded towards the Hispanic Peninsula, then his son was supposed to be the ruler, but his son was still a small child. So his uncle was Theodoric the Great, took control of the throne while his nephew was able to grow and become the king himself. So during the 6th century, Theodoric the Great is going to be ruling over this huge territory that includes part of Greece, part of Italy, well, all Italy actually, and also Spain. So he's going to be ruling over a huge territory in Europe, both the Ostrogothic and the Visigothic kingdom. Now, for the next questions, you have to mark only the two answers that indicate the end and the beginning of the century. So the 6th century, of course, starts when Odoacer deposes Romulus, that is the end of the 5th century. Or also we said that it could be that we could name the end of this century when Clovis defeats Siagrus, which means that the Frankish expansion starts. From that point on, the Franks are going to be expanding their power and territories. Remember that Siagrius was a governor in a Roman territory, and after the fall of Rome, the only free Roman territory was ruled by Siagrius. But then Clovis defeats Siagrius, Clovis defeats this last Roman territory, and he becomes as you know, the king of the Franks, which is going to be expanding the territory a lot, all the way to Spain. So that would be the beginning of the 6th century, the expansion of the Franks. And by the end of the century, we have the birth of Islam. And during the 7th century, we're going to see all the expansion of this new religion. So the 5th century, of course, starts when Alaric the Visigoth sacks Rome. If you remember, this is the first thing that we saw. And of course, it ends when Odoacer deposes Romulus or Clovis defeats Siagrus. Because, of course, the end of the 5th century is obviously the beginning of the 6th century, okay? Then finally, all those questions, you could find them just using your cards. All that information was very clearly in your cards of the century. However, over here, these questions were intended for you to think the relation between the centuries. to think how we are studying the centuries to be able to get very nice detail, but there are processes that go beyond the century. So this part of the exam was intended for you to be able to link, to relate processes that happen between different centuries, and for you to be able to observe how we have processes of long duration, processes that take longer than a century. So that was the intention behind this part of the exam. So all you had to do was relate things that happened between centuries, okay? So how is Charlemagne related to the end of the Middle Ages? Well, that is very easy, because if you remember, we said that the early Middle Ages are going to be ending with the beginning of the feudal institutions and with the beginning of the Viking incursions. So that is happening, of course, with Charlemagne. He's going to be founding the feudal institutions that, if you remember, are this way of dividing the territory between noblemen, between counts, dukes, and marquises. And those noblemen are going to be in charge of protecting those territories. They are going to be like the generals in charge of protecting those territories from any kind of invasions. But, however, they are also going to be let's say, kind of ruling those territories in the name of Charlemagne. Charlemagne is still the emperor, is still the king, but these people are going to be ruling those territories in the name of the emperor, and they are going to be in charge of administrating those territories, of managing those territories, sorry, and of course of protecting them, mainly of protecting them in case of war. Then what is the relation between the entry of Islam to Europe and the coronation of Charlemagne as Roman Emperor? This was very important because you have to see how certain events would cause great repercussions. So in this case, if you remember, Islam enters Spain, they are able to conquer Spain, but they were about to enter France too. They were about to conquer all Europe. But the grandfather of Charlemagne, Charles Martel, is able to stop them in the Battle of Poitiers in the Pyrenees, in the Mount Pyrenees. So by that effect, as Charles Martel is able to defeat the Muslims in the Battle of Poitiers, then the Carolingians get the crown of France. And as they keep growing in power, then by the end of the next century, by the end of the 8th century, they are going to be able to, well, they are going to get the crown of Roman emperors, if you remember, of this new Roman Empire, and they are going to be, well, Charlemagne is going to be crowned by the Pope Leo III. So this process starts precisely over here, when Charles Martel is able to stop the invasion in the Battle of Poitiers, and it ends when Charlemagne is named emperor, is crowned emperor. What is the relation between the fall of Rome and the entry of Islam to Europe? Which kingdom is deeply related to both events? Well, they are, of course, the Visigoths. If you remember, the Visigoths were the ones who sacked Rome. They were the direct responsibles for the fall of Rome. And finally, Islam is going to be defeating Don Rodrigo, which was the last king of the Visigoths. So this kingdom of the Visigoths is going to exist from the 5th century all the way to the beginning of the 8th century. By the beginning of the 8th century, we have the fall of the Visigothic kingdom, and that was like this huge process, let's say this process of very long duration, that was the Visigothic kingdom, in which, it starts when Alaric sacks Rome, Alaric the Visigoth sacks Rome, and it ends when the Muslims kill Don Rodrigo, the last Visigothic king, okay? What difference may you find between the Pippins and the Constantine's donations? Well, even if both of them are trying to give the territories of Rome to the Pope as the rightful heir of Saint Peter, the Constantine's donation is a fake donation. It's a fake document. If you remember, it is a forgery. It is a document that was written precisely in the 7th, in the 8th century, more or less in the 8th century, and it is intended to make people believe that the Emperor Constantine in the 3rd century had originally given those territories to the church. But that was false, that was a lie. But they presented this document to Pippin, the father of Charlemagne, King Pippin the Brief, and he's going to rightfully give those territories to the Pope, at least in paper. That donation is not going to end until Charlemagne in the 8th century is able to conquer Italy, and he's is going to give those territories to the Pope. But the difference is that the Constantine's donation was a fake document used to convince Pippin of giving those territories to the Pope, and the Pippin's donation is actually the legal document which actually gave the territories to the Pope. Then, finally, what relation might you find between the sack of Rome by Alaric and the defeat of Attila the Hun in the Battle of the Catalonian Plains? Well, the answer is that they were both carried out by the Visigoths. And if you remember, this is very, very interesting, because it means that even after Alaric sacked Rome, the Romans actually again rehired the Visigoths to ask Federati to fight their battles. And what they did was, of course, defeat the Huns. They defeated Attila, the Punishment of God. That was his nickname. They defeated Attila, and thus they were able to return to the grace of Rome even after they had invaded the Roman city. So that was it for the exam. I hope that you are able to see what you have to study, how you have to study for now on. And well, that was it. Thank you, girls.